This talk is about limits on the adaptive security of Yahoo Scabbling. It is joint work of Chetan Kamat, Krzysztof Pieczek, and Daniel Wicks. Consider the following scenario. Alice holds some circuit C, Bob holds some input X, and they want to jointly evaluate the circuit on input X without revealing their respective secret information. Yahoo suggested the following solution to this problem. First, Alice gobbles the circuit, and I will show you a bit later how this precisely works, and sends over the gobbled circuit C tilde. Alice and Bob then run an oblivious transfer protocol so that Bob learns the gobbled input and can evaluate the gobbled circuit on the gobbled input to learn C of X. While this scheme was presented already in the 80s, its security was analyzed only much later. The first security proof was due to Lindahl and Pinkas in 2009. However, it was in a selective setting where the input is known ahead of time. Adaptive security then follows via randomly guessing the input. However, this involves a loss in security that is exponential in the input size. Later, Chafagoli and Wicks proved adaptive security at a loss that is exponential only in the depth of the circuit. So for NC1 circuits, for example, they achieve security of Yahoo scheme at the polynomial loss in security only. In this talk, we are interested in lower bounds on this loss in security. More precisely, we proved that for any black box proof of adaptive indistinguishability for Yahoo scabbling scheme, for circuits with n-bit input, 1-bit output, and depth d smaller or equal to n, from an in-CPA secure secret key encryption scheme, incurs a security loss that is exponential in square root of d. Note that this lower bound only applies to Yahoo-specific construction, and we do not prove a separation of gobbled circuits from one-way functions. In fact, Hemingway et al. Gave a construction of adaptively secure gobbling from one-way functions using somewhere equivocal encryption. However, this scheme is less efficient than Yahoo's scheme since its online complexity increases with the pebble complexity of the circuit. Our results hold even for indistinguishability, which is a weaker notion than simulatability, which is usually considered in the context of gobbling schemes. And furthermore, we consider a variant of Yahoo that was introduced by Chafagoli and Wicks, where the output mapping is sent online. Clearly, it is easier to achieve security for this variant of Yahoo. So again, this makes our lower bound only stronger. The only previously known limitation of Yahoo's scheme was due to Applebaum et al., who proved that Yahoo's original scheme is not adaptively simulatable for circuits with large output. So our result differs in three aspects. First, we consider indistinguishability instead of simulatability. Second, we consider the variant of Yahoo that was introduced by Chafagoli and Wicks and for which they could prove an upper bound. And finally, we consider circuits of constant output. Before discussing the proof, let's recall Yahoo's gobbling scheme. To gobble a circuit, Alice assigns a key pair for each wire in the circuit. And for each gate in the circuit, she computes double encryptions under all possible input combinations and assigns this gate a gobbling table G tilde that contains these four ciphertexts in randomly permuted order. The gobbling of the circuit then consists of all these gobbling gates and the secret key that Alice holds consists of all the input key pairs. Clearly, this can be computed offline and independently of the input. For an input X, the gobbled input then contains the respective input keys. And finally, there's also an output mapping that allows to map output keys to output bits. So if Bob holds one key for each input wire. This allows him to decrypt exactly one of the four double encryptions and receive exactly one of the two output keys. And then he can use the output mapping to map this key to a bit. For security, we consider the notion of indistinguishability, where in the selective setting, the adversary chooses a circuit C, two inputs X0, X1, and receives a garbling of C and a garbling of one of the two inputs. Note that this notion is clearly weaker than selective simulatability, but furthermore, it is also a very weak notion of indistinguishability because we do not consider circuit hiding but only input hiding. However, again, this makes our result only stronger because we consider lower bounds. In the adaptive setting, the adversary first receives the guarding of the circuit and then can adaptively choose inputs X0 and X1. To prove our theorem, we define two oracles, F and A. F will be an ideal secret key encryption scheme that in particular is information theoretically in CCA secure. And A will be an inefficient adversary that breaks Yao's scheme by brute force breaking the encryption scheme, but still it will not be too helpful in breaking the encryption scheme. More precisely, to define A, we need to define a carefully crafted circuit C that maps all input strings to the constant bit 0. And the adversary then chooses X0, X1 uniformly at random and decides whether to output the bit 0 or 1, depending on some good predicate. Clearly, it is crucial to define the circuit C and good predicate such that the adversary indeed succeeds and breaks the garbling scheme. And we will define this good predicate through some pebble game on graphs. More precisely, given the garbled circuit and the garbled input, the adversary extracts some pebble configuration on the circuit. The adversary does this by brute force breaking all the encryptions contained in a garbling table and checking whether they are correct with respect to the input keys it learns during evaluation of C tilde on input XB tilde, and with respect to the bits that would run over these wires when C is evaluated on X0. We then consider a pebbling game, where in each step one can place or remove a pebble on a node if at least one of its parents carries a pebble. To get an intuition on this pebbling game, consider for example the following pyramid graph and assume we want to pebble the sink of this graph. Then we can start by placing a pebble on any source node and then can place a pebble on a child of this source node, then can remove the pebble on the source node. Note that we can always place pebbles on any source node because the source doesn't have any parents. We can then continue until we have placed a pebble on the sink of this graph, and we can then remove all the remaining pebbles also following the same pebbling rules, but again we have to place a pebble on the source node to remove the second last pebble and can also remove the last pebble. The pebbling game that we consider for our lower bounds is in fact significantly more involved, but this is outside the scope of this preliminary talk. Such pebble games have turned out very useful for proving adaptive security of various cryptographic primitives that involve some graph structure. Having this pebble game in mind, we then define a pebble configuration to be good if it is reachable with less than d pebbles, where d is some threshold that is linear in the depth of the circuit. We then prove that for appropriately chosen circuit C with high pebble complexity, the adversary will extract a good Peplink configuration when it receives a gobbling of x0 and a bad configuration when it receives a gobbling of x1. Note that clearly the adversary, by construction, will extract an empty Peplink configuration whenever it receives an honest gobbling of the circuit and x0. To capture the idea that our adversary is not too useful for any reduction, we define a punctured adversary that has the InCPA challenge ciphertext C-star hard-coded and never decrypts this ciphertext, but instead assumes that this would encrypt the all zero string. Clearly, it is not useful for any reduction. However, a reduction can only distinguish A of C-star from A if the Peplink configuration that A extracts is good, whereas in the same execution of the game using the same randomness, the Peplink configuration that A of C star extracts is bad. We then prove that P and P star differ in at most one valid Peplink move according to our Peplink game. And this then implies that the reduction can only distinguish A of C star from A if P contains D-1 pebbles and is good. We then prove that it is very unlikely for the reduction to reach such a threshold configuration. More precisely, we prove that for any gobbled circuit C tilde, the probability over uniformly random input x0, that there exists a gobbled input xb tilde, such that p is good and p star is bad, is very small. And to prove this lemma, we use the following two properties. So first, the property that we just established, that p must contain many pebbles. And second, we will argue that the reduction needs to correctly guess the output of all pebbled gates during evaluation of C of x0. To guarantee these properties, it is now crucial how to define the circuit C. First, C must have high Peplink complexity, in particular at least D, our threshold. Furthermore, we define C to contain a block of XOR gates, which maintains high entropy, and pebbles on this block correspond to guessing the input x0. Furthermore, our circuit contains subsequent AND gates that serve as some control mechanism. Pebbles on these gates mean that some guess on the previous XOR block was incorrect. In a bit more detail, our circuit looks as follows. It contains a so-called tower graph, where all gates are implemented as XOR gates. By some linear algebra results, we can show that for randomly chosen x0 and x1, the output of CXOR will differ. And we then use the fact that AND gates are asymmetric with respect to their input, so we can use them as control gates. So if we consider such a different output for x1 compared to the output of CXOR on input x0, if this is an input to an AND gate, then this AND gate will be considered pebbled by the adversary. We then prove a pebbling lower bound for the CXOR graph structure, namely that placing a pebble on layer D requires at least D pebbles on the XOR circuit. But since for C tilde x1 tilde, the adversary extracts a pebble on an AND gate on layer D plus 1, and such an AND gate can only be pebbled if a parent in the XOR circuit was pebbled, this implies that the adversary extracts a bad Peplink configuration and implies that the adversary indeed breaks the gobbling scheme. To complete the picture of our circuit, it contains AND gates for each input and each XOR gate. And whenever a gate evaluates wrong or some input key is wrong, then a corresponding AND gate is pebbled and the adversary automatically extracts a bad configuration independently of the challenge. This implies that the reduction needs to place D-1 pebbles on the XOR circuit, and for each of these pebbles it needs to guess the output during evaluation of C on input X0. However, for any subset of D gates in this XOR circuit, there exists a subset of square root of D gates such that their output bits are independent. And actually this bound is optimal. For example, if you would place all these pebbles in a square, then indeed you could only find a square root of the number of pebbles that have independent output bits. This implies that the reduction succeeds with probability at most 1 over 2 to the square root of d. Finally, to complete the picture of the circuit, we add a binary tree of AND gates that guarantees constant output 0. I hope I could give you some intuition on the proof. And to conclude, we considered black box reductions that prove security of Yao's scheme based on the security of the underlying encryption scheme. And starting from the upper bound by Chafogoli and Wicks, that is exponential in the depth of the circuit, we prove a lower bound that is exponential in square root of the depth of the circuit. In this talk, we left out many details and many technicalities, and we refer to the full version of our paper, which is on ePrint. Finally, I want to mention some open problems. First of all, it would be interesting to close the gap between our lower bound and the upper bound by Chafogoli and Wicks. We believe that our lower bound could be improved, potentially even to a bound exponential in the depth, but this would require a more sophisticated pebbling lower bound. At the moment, we do not know how to do that. Another interesting problem would be if one can achieve a stronger lower bound for Yao's original construction, where the output mapping is sent in the offline phase. Recall that Applebaum et al. Already proved a lower bound for simulatability for Yao's original construction for circuits with large output. On the other hand, in a concurrent work that we published on ePrint, we gave an upper bound for indistinguishability for Yao's original scheme that depends on the tree width. However, an interesting result in this direction could be to construct circuits of small depth and small output that incur a loss exponentially in the input size, potentially even for indistinguishability. Another interesting problem would be if one can turn our lower bound into a concrete counterexample. Such a counterexample could be a very contrived encryption scheme, even based on obfuscation. Finally, let us mention that we hope that similar ideas could be used for other constructions of gobbling, or even to analyze completely different cryptographic primitives. Thanks for listening to this talk. I hope to see many of you in the live session at Crypto 2021.